On behalf of the U.S. Department of State, it is truly an honor to be here with you this afternoon as you finish what I hope was an amazing experience here in the United States, and that you will remember this experience forever. We will be joined this afternoon by a great friend of Africa and an exemplary representative of the people of the United States, the Honorable Chris Coons. United States Senator from Delaware. Senator Coons' interests in Africa are wide-ranging and long-standing. We are grateful for his advocacy for YALI and for AGOA, the African Growth and Opportunity Act. Senator Coons also leads congressional trips to Africa when his busy schedule permits. These visits help cement U.S. relations with and understanding of Africa. Senator Coons is also the ranking member of the State Foreign Operations Appropriations Subcommittee and a member of the Senate Foreign Relations, Africa, and Global Health Subcommittee. Senator Coons and two of your colleagues, Jacquiline, Amongin, a member of parliament from Uganda, and Pamela Mate, information officer for the Namibian parliament, will engage in a discussion with our moderator, Frank Sesno, on investing in the next generation of Africa. YALI is one of our nation's most vibrant and meaningful investments in the next generation of Africa, which is you. And all that you bring to the program, your talent, your passion, and your potential. You represent Africa's future. You are Africa's greatest resource, and one of the reasons we are so optimistic about the continent's future. Africa is the youngest continent, and its population will double by the year 2050. We know that you, as fellows, working in civil society, entrepreneurship, or public management, have a role in creating jobs and education opportunities, engaging civil society, and increasing confidence in and adherence to the rule of law. All of these will help make Africa more stable and more prosperous, which helps all of us. Empowering young people is at the heart of the U.S.-Africa relationship. Our mission is to partner with Africa and Africans to promote democracy, peace, prosperity, and opportunity. There is no better partner than all of you, the Mandela Washington Fellows. Let's give you a hand. You have already made a big difference through your work at home. And we hope the fellowship allows you to have an even greater impact upon your return. As you think about your future, consider a quote by the late U.S. President John F. Kennedy. Ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country. Today may mark the end of your program here in the United States. But in fact, it is the beginning of a long-term partnership. And it is the beginning of the next chapter of your lives back home. Stay in touch with what you learned here. Stay in touch with each other. Stay in touch with the U.S. Embassy. Maintain contact with the YALI Network, our regional leadership training centers. Take advantage of the professional development, mentoring, networking, training, and funding opportunities you will have as graduates of this remarkable program. The next steps towards what you can achieve for Africa are now up to you. In conclusion, know that you are going to change lives for the better. You are going to change the trajectory of your countries in a positive way. Congratulations to all of you for what you have accomplished so far and for what you have yet to achieve. I can't wait to hear about the great work that you will do. And now, let's hear from the Honorable Senator Coons and your two colleagues, along with Frank Sesno. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Honorable Chris Coons, U.S. Senator for Delaware, 2017 Mandela Washington Fellows, Jacquiline Amongin and Pamela Mate, and our moderator, Frank Sesno, Professor of Media and Public Affairs and International Affairs at the George Washington University.
Is it, Jackie have her friends here?
Yeah.
Does Pamela have her friends here?
Yeah.
Does the senator have his friends here?
Yeah.
Well, welcome to all of you. It's so great to be back. I had the incredible privilege and pleasure of being at this gathering last year, and we had an amazing conversation last year, and we were so impressed that we asked three of the amazing Yali Mandela Fellows to come back to Washington, which they did, funded by the State Department and IREX in April, and spent a week with us to teach and for us to learn and for to share. So I hope that'll happen again. So welcome, everybody. So let me quickly introduce our panelists. We're going to open this conversation to you. I hope you have lots of great questions. Congratulations on the session that you have had and the experience you've had. First, this is Jacquiline Amongin. She is a member of the Ugandan Parliament. She is a member of the Pan-African Parliament as well and has her own foundation. Pamela Mate is a senior information officer at the National Council at the Namibian Parliament. She is very concerned among her issues with issues relating to girls and women. And she is also very interested in communicating what the parliament is doing so people can understand and engage. And Senator Chris Coons is a senator from the great state of Delaware. It is not the biggest state in America, but the senator believes it is the best state in America. So just a little bit more as we start our conversation. Jacquiline, tell us maybe, and each of you, something from your experience as a Mandela Fellow and in your experience at the university. You were at Bridgewater State, is that correct?
Sure.
Okay. Something you're taking away from this.
First of all, I have one mentor. That's my late grandfather, who told me that a house is not necessarily a home until you feel welcome to that house. And I want to thank, before I say anything, the great University of the Soil, Bridgewater State University, for giving us an opportunity not only to network, but an opportunity to learn the experiences and learn the cultural trends in the American context. And I go back to Africa very energized because I went to the different homesteads within Massachusetts and the Bridgewater community,
yeah.
And every homestead has a flag that shows patriotism. And I think that is something we should carry forward as the fellows
so
of 2017.
So what did you learn? What's a big takeaway for you?
The big takeaway for me, today, as I sit in this room, having learned from the different speakers that I've heard from day one when I came to this Mandela Fellowship, is how do we fulfill the dream, the African dream?
The African dream.
Sure.
Great. Pamela Mate?
You were at Syracuse University?
Yes, I was.
Syracuse? At the Maxwell School?
Yes.
So what were you studying and spending your time on?
First, I would also like to thank Professor John McPeak. I don't know if he's around. And all the other 25 fellows from Syracuse who have spent the last 6 weeks with me. It's been a great honor and a privilege. What we did at the Maxwell School of Public Affairs and Citizenship, which is also the number one school in the country for that matter, is a host of issues around public management and administration of governance issues, ranging from things that might not necessarily be important or deemed important, such as the not-for-profits and doing community work, and things that make us also think outside the box on how we can help our governments function. Because the one thing that is a takeaway for me is that we were told that government cannot solve everything, and this is something that Africans, as individuals, we need to understand that our governments need us to work with them. We are the collaborators of the efforts of government, and we should not stand outside and just criticize, and that is probably the biggest thing for me that the Maxwell School has taught.
So you will take that back to Africa with you?
Yes.
And what will you do differently with that knowledge?
It's a work ethic. It's a strong work ethic that I've seen with the people of America. People in little to the great stuff. You can imagine when we were in Cortland at the YCMA, you find that people doing the smallest things are very passionate about what they're doing. They're very knowledgeable about what they're doing. And that is the one thing that I can say is the strong work ethic that I hope to take with and emulate and let other people also carry that thing with them.
Senator Coons, I want to introduce you to the room and the room to you. You were here last year at this conversation. You are a powerful and a committed Africanist. Where did that come from? Where did that start? Tell that story.
It came from a very similar experience that I had back in 1984. When I had an opportunity to spend a semester at the University of Nairobi in Kenya. And I had the opportunity on that visit in 1984 to stay with different families in different regions of the country, up in Samburu, west, north of the lake in Kisii country, in Nairobi in Buruburu Phase 3, and then out in Lamu. And every family with whom I stayed showed me just stunning hospitality, remarkable kindness, open-heartedness that genuinely changed my view of my life, my place in the world, and gave me a sense of Africa's commitment to family, to hospitality, and to community. And then in 1987, I went to South Africa and worked with the South African Council of Churches. Those two experiences really anchored for me a lifelong passion for trying to strengthen the relationship between the United States and the 54 countries of the continent. And so I am so grateful for a chance to learn from you again today, to welcome Pamela and Jacquiline, to welcome a new Yale Mandela Fellow to my office. We have a fellow from Guinea-Bissau who begins his work this week, and to once again visit the continent. I am leading a bipartisan delegation later this month to four countries in West Africa. It is an enormous blessing to have some small role in supporting this fellowship and in supporting this relationship.
Which countries are you going to?
We'll be going to Gambia, Ghana, Cote d'Ivoire, and Nigeria.
You say your experience changed your life?
Yes.
How?
It helped me to see America's role in the world differently, to have some more humility about how the United States is seen, how we influence the rest of the world, and to be more open to the rest of the world influencing us, to see the strength of the African diaspora in my own state and my own country, and to recognize some of our limitations. I was in Africa during the struggle against apartheid, and at that point, the American government's position was wrong. It was on the wrong side of history. And it challenged me to rethink some of the worldview that I had been raised with and some of the assumptions I had been raised with. And the focus, the priority that was placed by the families with whom I lived on being connected to each other, on being connected to history, and connected to community, challenged some of the assumptions of the American dream, that you are an individual and you are not accountable to your history or your context or your family. So these were just a few of many ways it helped influence
me. And you absorbed a little culture.
Just a little.
And you absorbed a little language.
Nimi sehalzote.
Let me come back to you, Jacquiline. In thinking about leadership and the value of a program like this and the influence that you have on people here through your presence and that your experiences have here on you and what you're going to do, how do you see the role of YALI in that two-sided equation?
For me, I'm extremely very excited that I became part of this team, being one of the youngest legislators in the continent.
You're one of the youngest legislators on the continent?
In the continent, and I feel honored, first of all, by this opportunity to associate with 1,000 young people from the great continent of Africa. And having gone through the different learnings here, members coming from entrepreneurship cohort, public management cohort, civic leadership cohort, I feel we are ready to move and move Africa to a certain level. And being a legislator, I think this is an opportunity that I've intermingled, I've created networks with these great young people of the continent in trying to make the business environment conducive by passing legislation that are pro those businesses to be sustainable in the continent.
Is that your top priority, getting business promoted?
As a legislator, I'm interested because I cannot sustain politics without prospering businesses. That is also a top priority for me as a legislator. But bottom line, this is like giving us an opportunity. Everyone seated in this room today is very important in his own or in her own right. So this gives us an opportunity to rethink our agenda. Our agenda in terms of moving the continent and make it one of the greatest continents in the world, both in the political sphere, in the public sphere, in the business sphere, and in civil society engagement. And for me, it's really an honor, and I think the sky should just be the beginning for the people seated in this room.
You heard that, right? It's the beginning. Pamela, what's your take on that? How does this program work, and how does your experience work on both sides?
Okay, Frank, when we speak of things such as Agenda 2063 may be too far, because already it is expected by the year 2035, the 1 billion plus people in Africa would have doubled. And we also expect that these people will be living longer. So the onus is on me and everybody in this room to make sure that the infrastructure of 2035 to 2040, that schools, that health, ICT, and all these other factors that would help Africa be on par with the rest of the world are in place. And so because of the networks that I've created, I, not knowing even that I would meet people that could speak to an interest that I wasn't even aware of, this has created in each and every one of us that connection and that ability to go back to our countries and at least be able to know that you can refer somebody to someone else, and it will just fasten the whole process of developing and bringing Africa to the way it's supposed to be.
I want to read something that Kristen Lord, who's president of IREX, which is helping to support all of this, wrote not some time ago under the title, "A Rising Tide of Servant Leaders is Transforming Africa," which is just exactly what we're talking about. She wrote this: "Africa is right now richer, healthier, safer, more peaceful, better educated, and more democratic than any time in modern history." She continued, "Across Africa, there is an explosion of entrepreneurship, artistic creativity, cutting-edge design, and scrappy tech savviness. There are 3 cell phones for every 4 Africans. And in Nairobi, the Silicon Savannah, it is easier to pay for a cab by cell phone than it is in New York City." Senator Coons, this is to you, but then I'd like for both of you to join in. This is an incredible moment. It's not one that people in the United States hear very much because my industry, the media, don't focus on these stories very much. But what is the challenge and the opportunity for leadership facing this moment?
This is a moment when Africa truly is taking its leadership role in the world. The 21st century, I am convinced, will be an African century. There are inevitable changes of demographics that will align the natural resources, the human resources, and the untapped potential of Africa to make this an amazing century of growth and opportunity if the people of Africa take the opportunity that's right in front of us. And so I think you and the other Yali fellows I've had the honor of meeting in recent years exemplify just that kind of entrepreneurship, whether in elected leadership, whether in community leadership, whether in business leadership. You just heard from Tony Elamilu, a friend and an entrepreneurial leader from Nigeria. Did you have a good conversation with Tony? Was that inspiring? And I think he represents a new approach to reinvesting in African entrepreneurship. What we're looking for, what we're hoping for, is African-led solutions to African problems. And we've seen that innovation all over the continent. I will tell you two quick examples, if I might. One of the reasons I'm a big champion of Yali, specifically, is when I went to Liberia during the Ebola crisis, I got to meet with a whole group of Yali returned fellows. All of them had been at university when the Ebola outbreak began. All of them had the kinds of connections and resources that they could have fled Liberia had they chosen to. But instead, everyone with whom I met had left their schooling and dove into addressing the problem, to trying to innovate solutions, to coming up with Liberian solutions to contact tracing, to safe burial, to clean water, to transportation and logistics. They stepped up and helped address a problem with solutions that I suspect will then end up helping their country and the region, maybe the continent. And when I've most recently been to Nairobi, the energy and the excitement of the Silicon Savannah you just referenced is unbelievable. I got a call last week from an American tech entrepreneur asking me for advice. He's just gonna pick up and move to Nairobi, he said, because it's the most exciting tech startup hub on the planet. He'd rather be there. He'd rather be there than in San Francisco and Silicon Valley, than in Shanghai or in Singapore. And that sort of optimism, that sort of opportunity, and those of us who see it clearly in the United States and around the world, I hope will give you the confidence to continue as Yali Fellows. I'm so grateful to IREX, to Ambassador Sullivan, who we just heard from, and the State Department for their support of this program. But you're really the folks who are gonna help make this possible. You're the leaders who are gonna make this an African century.
Pamela, how are you gonna make this an African century? How do you take these opportunities? How do you see this leadership challenge from your perspective?
From my perspective, I know that Africa needs strong political leaders, and it needs drastic economic reforms. And so for Africa, or from my personal experience and in trying to make Africa the Africa that we all hope to see, is by trying to include people in the lawmaking processes. That is the only way we can make leaders accountable, because the leaders are not held accountable because nobody knows. They can complain, but they do not know the processes that they have to put in place for their issues to be heard. The education levels have to come to a point where people are able to read and understand and interpret the laws themselves. And so through the work that I also do at Parliament is to try and help people become part of the lawmaking process, not for the laws to come from one house.
To engage the public.
But to engage. Yeah, yeah. And for them to also participate, yeah, and contribute and be part of the legislature, so that they then can say, no, this is not what we asked for when we said that this is what we wanted. And that is how our governments will act on their feet. They will be responsive to the needs of the people, because without people participating in democracy, this situation, I don't see how fast it can change.
Jacquiline, you're in a leadership capacity now, so you must think about this all the time.
Thank you, Chris. And first of all, there's one thing that we need to all, I don't believe in people who keep complaining all the time.
I believe in people who take action. I took action when I was a student in the university, and I became a member of parliament 7 years ago. I was in the community that was always complaining, this is wrong, this is right, this is wrong. If we must change the situation in our communities, in our societies, we have to stand up to be counted. We have to try to get to those elected positions that we want to, if we must influence change. We must, if we are business people, try to influence positions in the business, in trying to influence the business agenda. I believe, and I have a strong belief, that if we all stood up today, not everyone can go into an elective position, but everyone here today, those of you who read the Bible, there's a saying that there were those seeds that went on the rock, there are those seeds that went on a fertile soil. So out of the 1,000 of us, how many of us are going to be falling on the fertile soil to multiply what we have got from here? How many of us, today I've had wonderful presentations here by Tony and also the gentleman before. He said, excuse me, don't go and mingle up. Stand out, let your ideas stand out. My ideas have stood out, I'm proud about that. Those who come from Uganda, my ideas have stood out in the Parliament of Uganda because I believe in them, irrespective of my age. My ideas, I believe in them, and I know they will continue to stand because I do them with a passion, and I do them with data, and I do them with analysis. One thing I really want to leave out to the crowd here, to the people, to the young leaders of today and tomorrow. Do not, even to myself, do not be part of those who go by the crowd. Be a team that sings so that when you stand up to speak, you're speaking with data, you're speaking with influence, you're speaking and everyone listens to you, just like the way we're all attentively listening to Tony today in this room. That should be you and me when we get back to the continent today. Because I know you're already doing great, and you are doing great.
I want to come to your questions in just a minute. There's so much more we could talk about. I could do this for hours. And I'll come back with you. I'll work for you. But I think, Senator, we should talk for just a minute about where we stand in this country and why the United States invests in a program like this, and why, and this question is asked a lot, whether it will continue to invest in a program like this.
Well, I can speak for myself and then hopefully speak as well for my country. I am a member of the committee in the United States Senate that appropriates the money for our State Department. And sustaining this program is my top priority as an appropriator in the United States Senate. Now, that doesn't answer the question why. I'll also say that there are many Republicans and Democrats in the Senate who feel strongly about supporting the U.S.-Africa relationship. I've been blessed to have great partners in Senator Isaacson of Georgia, Senator Flake of Arizona, Senator Booker of New Jersey, who are also very active in and very passionate about this relationship.
And Republicans and Democrats both.
Republicans and Democrats, sorry. It is important that we learn from you. It is important that we show some of the best of what the United States has to offer, and I hope at the universities where you've studied and the communities where you've been welcomed that we've had a good experience. But it's also equally important to me that young Americans and American leaders come to Africa as well so that we have an exchange of mutuality, because I believe in you. I believe that you will be the leaders of the future of Africa in many different ways. In the nonprofit and for-profit worlds, in the elected worlds, in the faith communities you come from. But I think this is a relationship deeply worth investing in over the long term, not for some issue of today or tomorrow or even this year or this decade. I am convinced this is an important relationship that has a future for us and for you, for my country and for your country.
So what do you say, and I'm just going to ask this, and I'm sure some of you may have even had some experience not unlike this. One of your constituents comes up to you and says, you know, Senator, you're a great guy, but you spend an awful lot of time, you keep talking about this Africa thing, and you're right, it's, you know, Africans should have a better life, but how does that affect me? You know, I got to worry about my job. I got to worry about my roads that are falling apart. Why are you so interested in spending so much time on this faraway place?
Okay. I'll give you five quick reasons.
Do you ever get asked a question like that?
I get asked that all the time. First, I host an annual conference in Delaware called Opportunity Africa in order to emphasize the opportunities that are in Africa. Because the American press only talks about the negatives. It only wants to talk about disease and disaster and starvation. And it is completely missing the point. I find myself watching BBC or All Africa or CNN Africa rather than watching the mainstream American press because it just doesn't cover the positive stories about creation, entrepreneurship, innovation, and problem solving in dozens of countries. I am certain you met Americans who have no idea the reach and breadth and diversity of Africa, but there is also a very strong African diaspora community in the United States. And that is a vehicle for us to be woven more tightly together. Why would I care? Why should my state care? First, because the problems of this century are more likely to be solved in Africa than in America. And if you find the solutions to multi-party democracy, to tolerance, diversity, and inclusion in multi-faith nations, to technology and the solutions we need for clean water, clean air, and cleaner energy, then you will help develop the solutions that will help us as well. Your problems are our problems, and vice versa. Second, an enormous market. China has figured out that Africa is the most promising and important market of the 21st century. What's happened to the United States? Our interest and engagement seems to be fading. We want you to sell products to the United States. That's why I championed the African Growth and Opportunity Act to keep it possible for African goods to come to the United States, duty-free and quota-free. But that's also a great opportunity for my country and your country. Third, for peace and stability. If there are African solutions to peace and stability on the African continent, then we can end this practice of having former colonial powers deploying troops. We can end the possibility of any future deployment of American troops, and we can have an African solution to security challenges on the continent. Fourth, public health. If there's a pandemic in this century, it will probably come either from Asia or from Africa. And there are public health challenges that could affect the entire world that we can solve together. Last, democracy. If democracy continues to advance in Africa, it will become the model for the world. If democracy does not fully take root, and if impunity and corruption instead become the dominant form, and autocratic crony capitalism becomes the dominant form of governance in Africa, then I'm convinced it will become the dominant form in the world. If the United States actually cares about human rights, free elections, journalism, and democracy, we must be engaged in that work with you for this century, or confess that we don't truly believe in the things that we wrote when we founded this country. I think the future of securing democracy is in Africa. That's the 5 years.
I hope your constituents listen hard to that and hear those five points because they're important. And I just want to say what you said about the media and what this country and what this public is exposed to and the stories and the news and the people and the personalities and the breakthrough and the innovation from Africa is so limited that it is scandalous. And we need to do a much, much better job getting that story out. And it's something that we work on. What is your response, and very quickly, because then we'll go to the floor, I promise. What is your response to the Americans that you've met who don't understand why America should be engaged in Africa? Have you had that conversation?
Well, for the time that I've been here, for 6 weeks, I think the American people whom we visited were very excited about our being
Good.
Here. And I would imagine that they would love to continue engaging with the Mandela Fellows, especially in Massachusetts. And we are honored, we are with Senator Chris. Senator Chris, this is a wonderful program because the world has become a global village. When we come here, the 1,000 young people, we definitely create more over 1,000 getting back to Africa and learning what we are doing. And as we continue coming, they continue coming, we become permanent friends in addressing global challenges. Because we are talking about multilateral systems here. We are signing multilateral agreements, the Sustainable Development Goals. We are signing, we are negotiating at the World Trade Organizations. I mean, these issues cross-cut. And the more we continue engaging, the better for all the continents.
And you're building relationships and networks.
Yeah, sure.
What is your response to this?
I just want to touch on what Senator Chris said about the East or China having seen this in Africa before, but they missed Africa's most important gem. You know, they were on construction and other issues, but this here is what they should have focused on because this is the future. And so they put their hand on Africa, yes, but they missed the most vital thing, which is the future of Africa and it's the youth of Africa. So I think we're still okay. Something else about what I've experienced here, everybody has been welcoming. We have not had a situation where people are questioning why are you here or why is it important that you're here. It could be that they have not expressed it openly, but so far I cannot begin to mention any incidences where I've had people question. But just for in case people are questioning why this program is important, it's because we need to, when Africa is down, the rest of the world will never move at the pace that it's supposed to, because they need to carry and help move Africa up. So for the rest of the world, it is important that we become, that we sit at a table, not as giving in, but as actual equal partners. So it's important that for Africa to rise, it's not for Africa alone, but it is for the greater good of humanity and for the greater good of the world.
Let us go to your questions from the floor. Because there is a lot at stake and not a lot of time. So I'd like to take questions. I believe there are mics roving. So if you've got a question there, I see a gentleman in the back with the red vest. There we go. Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't see that. It wasn't a vest, obviously, but go ahead. Tell us, and if you could, tell us your name, where you're from, and if you could be as succinct with your question, we'll get as many questions and answers in as possible.
Thank you. My name is Edwin Mattis. I'm a risk analyst at the Central Bank of Liberia, from Liberia, and I'm from the public management track at the prestigious Georgia State University in Georgia, Atlanta. I'm smiling right now, Senator, because I've been trying to make a point for the last two previous sections, and you have just addressed that. Inasmuch as I personally appreciate the US State Department, the US government, IREX, and all the other partners that has made this program a success for us, I have also been very disappointed. And you spoke directly to my disappointment. We've been here for six, almost 7 weeks. Here in this room, we have 1,000 change agents across Africa who went through tedious and rigorous process of application. Some of us went through 6 months of preparation before we applied to come here. And to realize that our success story is not being carried by the international media, CNN, I don't see our names placed on the headline, ABC News, BBC News, but what we see that the report always on Africa is war, poverty. If we were breaking the rules of the US government now, it would have been reported. If we were having a strike action that is unnecessary, it would be reported. But we did a great job to be here. Why is it not being reported? Why are our successes not being celebrated? Why? Africa for us is a place that we call home. But Senator, in as much as you are passionate about seeing Africa becoming a prosperous continent, I tend to feel personally that this is something you are doing within a minority of the place you serve in the House of Parliament. How are you going to ensure that your colleagues, which I believe, and I may be wrong, majority of them do not share the positive sentiments that you share on the prosperous and growth in nature of Africa?
Right. Let's
How will you do that to get them to support you?
Thank you.
Thank you, Edward. Thank you, Edward, for the question, and thank you. Thank you to all of you again for the very hard work you did. You were chosen to be YALI Fellows out of, I think it was 64,000 applicants. So you yourselves are the product of an incredibly rigorous process. You have worked very hard to get here. And you highlight an important and painful fact that the American popular media today doesn't report on positive news of any kind, generally. Last week, there was a gathering also here in Washington of young scientists, competitors from 160 countries around the world. Young people from every imaginable country who were competing in a robotics competition. And the American entrepreneur who launched it called me and said, "Why is there no coverage of this positive event?" I said, "That's your answer. It's positive. No one's dying, no one's exploded, no one's protesting." And then the team from Burundi disappeared. And there was coverage. I'm not kidding.
It's true.
So I know it is frustrating that there hasn't been big coverage of the exciting potential of 1,000 African change agents gathered here. But recognize this is a flaw in our country, in our media, and in our culture today. That we cover disasters, we cover hurricanes, we cover shootings in our country as well as in your countries. This isn't something that is applied as a lens only to Africa. It is also the news in my home. When I turn on the news in my hometown, I will see fire, shooting, problems, accidents, and I think there was a great youth program this morning in Wilmington. There was a terrific art session this afternoon in Dover. There is a promising concert this evening, and none of it will be covered. So please, Edward, don't take it personally that the United States media is not covering this. And your question was, what will I do about it? To be brief, I will speak about this experience to my colleagues. When I return to this next year, I will bring a Republican colleague. When I travel to the continent later this month, I am bringing 7 colleagues with me, Republicans and Democrats, several of whom have never been to Africa. So I keep trying to bring the positive energy, the excitement, the love that I have experienced through YALI and through Africa to my colleagues. That is all I know how to do. Thank you for the opportunity.
I just want to say this, because as many of you know, I worked at CNN for many years, and I covered the White House for CNN, and I was the Washington bureau chief here. And what has happened across media is not only not reporting the news, but it is misleading the public in what is actually going on in the world. And my advice to you, my advice to my students, my advice to others in the public domain is you need to take even more of a role now in being your own storytellers. Yeah. And you have the power to do that. One of the Mandela fellows last year whom we brought back to Washington, and we brought her in, and she riveted the place. She works with women and girls. She takes her iPhone and her iPad when she goes, and she shoots videos and posts them on Facebook, and she has had thousands of views, moving to tens of thousands of views. And that can change minds and views too. But we got to fix the American media here, and that's going to be hard. Next question from the floor, right up front. And then we'll move around. And if you could be brief, if we could all be brief, we'll take a couple, because this guy's got to go back to work and save the world.
I'm Moise from Togo. Moise, I came from Togo. I was at the Driven to Discover University of Minnesota, Humphrey School of Public Affairs. I have a question, and it's addressed to the senator, and the two MPs. America is determined to help the young African leaders to bring the change in Africa. But most African head of states, they loot our countries, they bring that money here in the US. They invest, they put it in banks, either in USA or in Europe. Now, as a senator, what can you do about that? Because you are investing in us to bring the change. While we are trying to bring the change in our communities, they are now taking what we are doing and bringing it here. What are you doing about that? And dear fellows, we are also here determined to work all along with you to bring that change. What are you planning concretely to do on that very side, as far as legislation is concerned, and holding our head of state accountable?
Let's start with our Member of Parliament. And if you can be fairly quick, we can try to get a couple of other questions.
On elected leaders, especially heads of states investing in Europe and America, I may not verify that information, but they could be there. But also looking at the environment, for me as a legislator, what is very imperative is to make sure that the investment policies are in place, especially in the countries that they are not there, in place and favorable for nationals to be able to triumph in such countries that are struggling in terms of sustaining businesses. But bottom line, I think that if you look at the level of our leaders, I don't want to name, you can think that, you can see the generation is totally different. Like you've just said, we have to write our own stories, and our own stories start today. I know for most of us, they could have started yesterday. We are just in the journey. That's basically what I could say.
Okay.
Thank you.
What I can say is that in most African countries, especially in Southern Africa, we have this loyalty towards our political leaders because they brought us from the colonialism, and so there's this sense of loyalty to the liberation struggle movements. And that has created a lax or this apathy from our side to actually hold these leaders accountable. And the only way we can actually do that is through the ballot box. If you are unhappy with, be it at town level, your mayor, or be it what my sister here does at legislative or at state level, you should be able to hold people accountable through how you vote. Because the longer we keep people that are incompetent and also that do not have the interest of the people, the longer we keep them in office, the more we will see our natural resources being brought out of Africa to be invested somewhere else. Because Africa, what did they say? 7 out of 10 fastest growing economies are in Africa. So if our own leaders cannot even see that, then it's a problem.
Senator?
Yeah.
Accountability begins with transparency. Here, as a member of the United States Senate, I must publish every year all of my holdings. What do I own? What do I own in stocks, in properties, and investments? You can look it up on the internet. Having a comparable transparency and accountability is an important part of a functioning democracy. We in the United States can and should hold accountable heads of state who are destroying their own countries. But it should be an action that we only take after there have been many attempts at African-wide interventions and at democratic solutions. I recently visited South Sudan. In South Sudan, there is a genuine humanitarian crisis unfolding. And both the elected president and vice president and their factions are fighting each other to the destruction of their country, to give one example. I recently met with our Secretary of the Treasury, and I'm following up with a letter saying, we should begin to impose sanctions on those who are taking the resources of South Sudan and sending it outside the country instead of sitting down at a table of negotiation and resolving the conflict. So it should be in unusual or extreme cases where the United States takes such action. First would be democratic accountability from the bottom up. Second would be transparency. But third, we do have a role to play in cases where there are folks who are literally destroying countries and taking their resources. I think in those extreme steps, there is responsibility for the United States as well as for all of us. Thank you for the question.
Thank you very much. I am so sorry that we don't have more time, but the senator has to get back to the Hill, and you have meetings, I understand, as I say, where you're going to save the world and
save
Yali. But I would like to ask you to join me in thanking the senator and Pamela and Jacquiline for a tremendous conversation and for all that you've done. Thank you very much.
And we have the cards.
Thank you. Thank you, Senator.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome 2017 Mandela Washington Fellow, Dr. Ruby Goga.
Hello, everyone, and thank you for coming. I bring you warm greetings from Ghana. I've studied civic leadership at the Kansas State University these past 6 weeks. Go K-State! We were privileged to have General Myers speak to us in the first week of our institute. It was a meeting over lunch, and I remember I was one of the first in line. As I looked around for a seat, I saw there was a vacant seat next to the general. So what did I do? Any guesses? I walked right past the vacant seat and sat three places away from him because I kept thinking, what could I possibly say to a four-star general that would sound even remotely intelligent? For those of you who don't get why I was panicking, here's a little information. The grade of general of the Air Force in the United States is a five-star general officer rank, and it is the highest possible rank in the United States Air Force. It is reserved for wartime use only and has been held just once in the history of the United States. In times of peace, the grade of four-star general, which General Myers is considered as the highest appointment an officer can have. So, from my safe spot, three seats away from the general, I listened as he spoke to the fellows closest to him about everyday things, what they thought of Kansas, what their countries were like, whether they missed being away from home, and the work they were doing. From my seat three spots away, I thought to myself, I could have answered those questions. When we introduced ourselves, he knew most of our countries, and he had something to share with each one of us. So as fellows, he came across as being very ordinary. This was so different from what we are used to seeing in our countries, and I'll tell you why. He came to the meeting alone. There were no aides. There was no security detail, nothing. He served his own meal and carried it to the table himself and sat with us. He initiated conversation. He took selfies with us. Most big men in our countries don't do this. And General Myers is a big man. He served for over 40 years in the United States Air Force. He was appointed Vice Chairman of the Joint Chief of Staff by President Clinton in the year 2000. 20 days after 9/11, he was appointed as the 15th Chairman of the Joint Chief of Staff by President George Bush. As Chairman, he was the nation's highest ranking military officer and served as the principal military advisor to the President, the Secretary of Defense, and the National Security Council. He has received numerous awards and decorations for his service, including the Presidential Medal of Freedom. General Myers currently occupies the Colin Powell Chair for National Security Leadership, Character and Ethics at the National Defense University. He served on the board of directors of the United Service Organizations for a period of 10 years, six of which were as chairman of the organization. He also continues to serve on several public and nonprofit boards. Since his retirement from active service, General Myers has served as the foundation professor of military history and leadership at the Kansas State University. Go Wildcats! A year ago, he was appointed as the president of the Kansas State University, which is his alma mater, and which has been my home and the home of 24 other fellows these past 6 weeks. K-State! K-State! Please join me in welcoming General Richard Bowman Myers onto the stage. Thank you.
Well, I got to thank Ruby for that great introduction. I was told she'd worked on it. She didn't let me see it, but I knew she worked on it very, very hard, and it was delightful to meet her and her colleagues in Manhattan, Kansas, about six weeks ago. I want to thank IREX and the Department of State for allowing me to be here today to kind of close this session off. They said, we'd like your speech to be inspiring. And you know, when you're in front of a bunch of inspiring people, I don't know how I can inspire you. You're the ones that inspire me. You inspired the senator. You inspire so many people. So I'm not sure what I have to say can be inspiring, but I would like to talk to you about a couple of things. The first one is, never, never, never underestimate how important you are to your country, to your continent, to me, to all of us, to the world. I think Senator Coons did a great job of talking about how we're all interconnected. And, you know, as a people on this earth, as the billions of us on this earth, we're only as strong as the weakest group. And never underestimate what you bring to peace, security, and prosperity on this planet. You are absolutely amazing, and I appreciate everything you do and the fact that you are here with us in the United States for a short time. Clearly, you come from a continent that has many challenges, but what continent doesn't have challenges, right? Your challenges are actually not very different from the rest of the planet. We all have these challenges. You've got great resources to help you solve some of those challenges. A lot of continents do, some do not. But more than resources, more than governments, more than anything, the thing that will make the difference is you. You make the difference. People always make the difference. You can just reflect on your lives. It's always people that make the difference. Governments can help, resources can help, but you're the essential element in all of this. Last week I took, my wife and I took our five of our grandchildren to the Black Hills of South Dakota. I don't expect you to know where it is, but I do have a picture, I think, if they'll, okay, so there's a picture of Mount Rushmore. Anybody been to Mount Rushmore? I wouldn't expect you to have been to Mount. You have to travel a long way to a very sort of desolate part of our nation to get to Mount Rushmore. On that mountain, there are four faces of four presidents that the artists picked to depict America's first 150 years, our first 150 years. Those faces are not small. They are 20 meters high. Each face is 20 meters from chin to forehead high, or 60 feet. They're big faces. And I was sitting there, you know, what you do when you see those, they just overwhelm you a little bit. And I was sitting there looking at those faces, and I was thinking about what each president, why the artist picked each president to represent our first 150 years of this country. And I got to tell you, I'd been with with the fellows in Manhattan, Kansas, only about a month beforehand, and I thought about, well, those, and many would say, are sort of the key founding presidents through our first 150 years. I thought to the Mandela fellows, and I thought, you know, they have many of the same characteristics as these men. They have many of the same characteristics. The artist picked Washington, he's the one on the left. Of course, he was our first president, father of the country. One who they wanted to make Washington king after we declared our independence from Britain and won our Revolutionary War. They wanted to make him king. He says, no, this is a democracy. And they finally persuaded him to be president, but they wanted to give it all to him. And he said, no, this is a democracy. It's about the people. It's not about kings. The next person over is Thomas Jefferson. The artist thought that Thomas Jefferson was really important to the United States because he was involved in expansion, something called the Louisiana Purchase, which kind of doubled the size or tripled the size of what was then the United States of America. I think more importantly to me, Jefferson was the mind behind, one of the great minds behind our Constitution, and he was also the drafter of our Declaration of Independence, which is a fundamental document to what we as Americans believe in, freedom, democracy, and the pursuit of happiness, fundamental things that we believe in, and I think many countries actually believe in. Next to him is Teddy Roosevelt. They're kind of in the crevice. He put Teddy in there because he looked outward from the United States, and one of the things he did was help create the Panama Canal, connecting two great oceans and enabling trade. And then, of course, the one on the far right is Abraham Lincoln, and he's there because he held our country together in the midst of a terrible Civil War. So those are probably four pretty good choices if you want to pick presidents who influenced our first 150 years. And as I said, as I'm thinking there, looking at those, I kept coming back to the Mandela Fellows and what you mean to your country. And you may say, well, I'm not going to be carved in granite somewhere. I'm not going to be the president of my country, although I bet there are more than a few in here that will be. But it's the characteristics of those people that I think you embody, at least the ones I met in Manhattan, Kansas, and I'm sure I can translate to all of you as well. The first one would be diversity. All of those men had different styles, different character, looked at the world slightly different. No one style can do it all. Everybody has to contribute as they can. These four men each contributed in different ways to our growth as the United States of America, just as you'll contribute in your way. What they did was find their time and took advantage of the time they lived in to make their mark, and they did that. Each of those four presidents took great risk. Just an example, Thomas Jefferson, who was the drafter of the Declaration of Independence. We were declaring independence from, at the time, the greatest power on this earth, Great Britain. We were declaring, and we were just a puny nation. We didn't have a standing army. We had a ragtag army. We couldn't even issue them uniforms, sometimes not even muskets. So they took great risk, because if they failed, they would all be shot for treason. I think many of you actually took some risk to come to the United States. There's no question about it. You are risk takers. Probably most importantly, each of you has responded to the call to service. You wouldn't be here if you weren't called to being part of something bigger than just yourselves. Our group in Manhattan, Kansas had the great fortune to go over to the presidential library of President Eisenhower, his childhood home and his library. General Eisenhower, President Eisenhower, was one of my role models and heroes when I was growing up. I guess both of us being from Kansas, he was a natural choice. But he was also a very selfless individual. And every time I read something about President Eisenhower or General Eisenhower, or going through West Point, all the things he did to become what he became, I was always taken by how selfless he was in how he approached life. And if you're going to be a great public servant, I think you have to be selfless. Let me just tell you a little bit about my journey in selflessness. I don't claim to be a great selfless public servant, but I appreciate it, and I aspire to be that. And shortly after I retired, I was in New York City giving a talk to some investment bankers. And one of the young bankers, about your age probably, in his 30s, late 30s maybe, came up and poked me in the chest and he said, "General, it must really bother you to be the most senior military person in the United States of America, to have all that responsibility and to earn so little money." I said, "No, that's not why we serve. We don't serve for the money. And by the way, the money that the taxpayers give us through our government is adequate. It's more than adequate." He says, "Oh no, you and your peers, you and the other generals, you must talk about this every day, about how you're underpaid and so forth." I said, I've never had that conversation, I told him, with any other military person. That's just not what we talk about. And as I was walking home that night, I was thinking, here's that investment banker, and his whole definition, apparently, of his own self-worth is how much money he makes. The definition of my self-worth is, am I contributing appropriately to the security of my country? And those are two very different things. And I think all of you would probably identify with Eisenhower. You would not identify with the investment banker, who's all about how much money they get at the end of the year in a bonus or whatever. It's not to say money's not important. I'm not saying that. I'm just saying what drives you, and I know what drives you, or at least I know from the contingent of fellows that came to Kansas State University, and I'm assuming you're all fairly similar. What's driving you is something different than money. It's other ideals. It's this quest to be a good public servant, to make a difference in your communities and in your countries. And that's really admirable. And those four gentlemen on the carved in granite, that's what drove every one of them. It was not money. It was not fame. It was fortune. They took great risk and were successful in for the most part. I mean, think of the risk that Lincoln took during the Civil War. That was a very divisive time in our country. And he was assassinated. As the war concluded, he was assassinated because of his views. So he took great risks, showed great courage, and in the end, unfortunately, was killed. A couple other things on courage and risk-taking. When I was in South Africa at a conference on African development, I met a lady, Joyce Banda. At the time, Joyce was the vice president of Malawi. There we go. Back, yeah, so, and I was talking to her, by the way, we would go on these photo safaris together, and I would always dress down in some, you know, casual pants, casual jacket, my camera. Joyce Banda always dressed, looked to me like she was going to a wedding. She was beautifully dressed, always, and it's hot, it's dusty. I never saw her perspire. She looked beautiful the whole time. I mean, just as you all look today, the best I can tell, these lights are pretty bright, but just beautiful. Beside the point, when I was talking to the Vice President Banda, and we're talking about her service to Malawi. And at that time, she was vice president. Within a couple of months, she would be president, and that's a whole other story. But I said, "How long have you been doing this?" She said, "So long." She says, "You know, I've got grandchildren, and my whole family says for me to stop serving politically in Malawi." He said, "There have been two attempts on my life. They've not been successful, but there have been two attempts." I said, "Well, why do you do this?" Because she was not, you know, she's not a young lady. She's young, but she's not a young lady. She's got grandchildren. And she said, "It's all because I want to serve my country. It's public service." And later she became president. She had to make a lot of unpopular decisions to try to help put the country back on track, get international support, international money in there that had been driven out by other policies. I have a lot of respect for somebody like that. The other lady I'd like to talk about is not from Africa, from Afghanistan. Her name is Rula Ghani. Rula is the wife of President Ghani, and my wife is very close friends with her. They were on the phone one time about a year and a half ago in my kitchen just over here in Arlington, Virginia, and my wife Mary Jo was talking to Rula Ghani, and Rula was saying, well, there's shooting going on outside right now. There seems to be conflict in our neighborhood. And the security wants me to leave. As the wife of the president, they want me to leave my house. She said, I'm not leaving my house. This is where I do my work. I'm not leaving. I'm staying right here. Pretty big words for the wife of the president. And as you may or may not know, she's also a Christian in a Muslim country. And she's very strong about women's rights, very strong about women's rights, and draws, of course, a lot of criticism for not being a Muslim, being a Christian in that country. But she stands up and she's been counted, just like Joyce Banda stood up with threats to her life and was counted, just like those four men, and just like you do every day as you overcome the obstacles that you have to overcome. You know, it's often said that you are the future. And I'm going to beg to differ a little bit with that. You certainly are the future. You're our future. You're my future. You're my grandkids' future. The youngest was 8, the oldest was 15. Had 5 of them sitting there. Their future is tied to you and how successful you are. And I think that last panel kind of described that. We're all in this together. Your success will be their success. Their success will be your success if we get this right. But you're also not just our future, you're our present. You are the present. And let me tell you, I'm sure these stories are very typical. I wish you could all come to K-State. I could know more stories, but I'll tell you the ones that I do know. Amina Mohammed Jaji is the present. Amina is a dentist, a mother, and a medical student. She was bothered by a lack of opportunity for youth in her community and is working with local partners and policymakers to change how vulnerable youth are protected and served in the community. I mean, she's got a full-time job, right? And she's doing this. For Amina, her work is about youth empowerment. It's about facing down Boko Haram. It's about providing healthy and safe alternatives for the young people in her community. Amina's work is really about hope. And we know she is leaving here with a vision to move that hope to reality. So Amina, we thank you for that. Your president is Ahmed Afi, a 2017 fellow from Somalia with a vision for a stable, united, sovereign, and prosperous Somalia. For Ahmed, this vision includes women. It includes youth. It includes a strong democratic government committed to developing the resources from within to support the great people of Somalia. Ahmed, we appreciate your vision and what you're doing. And it goes on and on. Your president is Dalitso, working on rural initiatives in Malawi. Your president is Gloria of South Sudan, the youngest African nation that was discussed in that last panel. Your president is Brahim, moving forward on education reform in Mauritania. Your president is Abiy Diallo, a 2017 fellow who, alongside other... Yes, we can cheer for each other. We should cheer. I should cheer for you, but we should cheer for each other. Yali follows from Senegal, who have established a leadership development organization to empower and engage youth in the region for democratic governance and community. So, from those faces carved in granite that a lot of this country thinks are the right faces to have up there in granite, the traits they exhibited around risk and courage and diversity and public service, that's what I was thinking about when I was sitting there looking at those faces with my grandchildren. And I'm thinking, I'm looking at them and I'm wondering, do any of them have these traits? But then I thought back to a month before when I was in Manhattan, Kansas, at Kansas State University. And I know our fellows, and I know all of you have those traits, and you're going to need those traits because, you know, worthwhile work is never easy, just by definition. If it's worthwhile, it's not easy. It's hard. Progress is never a straight line. There are successes and there are failures. Perseverance. We must all persevere. I'm sure there are days where you're trying to run your foundation, start a business, get involved in policy, get involved in government, where you just said, I don't know if I can do this anymore. And then you gather yourself up, take a drink of water and say, okay, I'm back at it. I think we all go through those times. If you're in public service, if you're trying to make a difference, you gotta persevere. And as we kind of conclude this whole thing, I'd like you to remember a couple of principles of the Mandela Leadership Development Plan, which I'm sure you've all read very carefully, and I know you're doing some work in that area. But there are a couple of principles in there that I think are really, really important. The first one is, it takes more than a single heroic leader at the top to change the trajectory of an institution or a government. It takes all of us. One of the things about everybody in this audience, you now have a network that you can draw upon to give you strength, ideas, comfort when the going's tough, to make a difference. The second one was, in leadership, character is more important than strategy. Those four faces on that mountain, all of them had great character. Great character is what allows you to have really strong relationships, and relationships are how you make a difference. You trust one another, you become trusting and trustworthy. Great character enables that. If you have weak character, people aren't going to respond to you. So I think these two principles of the leadership development plan are ones to think about. So look around. Look at all these folks in here. I hope you've had a great time. But as you look at one another, you are the future, but you're also the present. You've got to be the present. Yeah, tomorrow's the future. We'll keep working on that. But you're the present. And this gathering is so important to how we're going to develop in this world as we go forward. There's no place more important, more in need of your kind of talent and the enthusiasm I hear. You're an enthusiastic crowd. You should be. And you got a lot to be proud of. We've got a lot of work ahead of us. I say we, because I do a little bit of small stuff in Africa in a not-for-profit sort of way. I hope our paths cross again. I look forward to next year. I hope Kansas State University will have the privilege of hosting another group of Mandela Fellows. I hope I can spend more time with them this coming next year than I did this year. I hope we're privileged to do that. This is a great program. Thank you for listening to me. I love all of you, and I hope you have a great experience in the United States of America. It's exactly 5 o'clock, so my guess is, I don't know who's coming out to give me the hook, but they talked about Q&A, but I think we're at the end, folks. I think I talked too long, so I'll just wish you good luck, and I think I'm gonna exit stage right. Thank you very much.